Korean Peninsula on the eve of these very important meetings of the UN. The crisis over North Korea, said to be number one on the agenda. We spoke with the South Korean Defense Ministry. They confirmed to us that two USB-1 bombers and four F-35 jet fighters from Guam and Japan, as well as South Korean and Japanese jets, were in drills today. They reportedly made an unusually close approach to the DMZ near North Korea and then dropped live bombs on a South Korean military target range. This, as the South Korean Defense Minister today said, that North Korea basically had completed its development of its intermediate range ballistic missile, just like the one we saw launch last week. Also, that they were in the final stages of development of ICBMs, which could hit the United States and could test another nuke anytime. This is officials here, yeah, looking very closely to the meetings of the UN to help them rein in Kim Jong-un after an important speech by President Trump tomorrow. Thursday, there'll be a three-way summit involving the president, the South Korean President Moon, Japanese Prime Minister Abe. By the way, the North Korean foreign minister could be in attendance tomorrow for President Trump's speech. Now, the question is, will North Korea give up its missiles and nukes in the face of all this diplomatic and economic activity? Here's the take of one longtime North Korea observer.
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No.
That's pretty grim.
Sure it is.
So then what are the options?
Well, it's deterrence and containment.
Deterrence and containment of the nukes that North Korea already has, military option if they try to use them. That's a solution that Washington might not want to hear, but it's one view at least from here in South Korea.
With tensions on the Korean Peninsula building, South Korea on Monday hosted a conference of military leaders from across Asia Pacific. Giving the keynote address was a former South Korean minister who's also headed the United Nations.
I'd like to remind North Korea that no single nation has survived its fate against unanimously united international community in the course of world history.
In the south, rising tensions are having an economic impact. At Imjingak, an hour from Seoul, it's easy to see into the demilitarized zone, the DMZ, and beyond that, the mountains of North Korea. The lookout has long been a tourist site. People can even take a train from here to just inside the DMZ. And despite the tensions, some visitors are still coming.
For me, my tickets were booked way in advance, so I had to make it. And we kept checking the news just to make sure that everything's kind of okay.
My sister was really worried, so my sister's actually getting married next week, and she was really worried that something was going to happen to me and I wouldn't be able to make it back. So it was a bit, she didn't really want me to come.
The US has like such a large military presence here and so many civilians that kind of trusted the Foreign Department to like take care of the US citizens and let us know if something was about to go down.
But visitor numbers to South Korea overall are down. 40% fewer came in July compared with the same month a year ago. On Sunday, most rides at the fun fair, which strangely is part of the Imjingak site, were near empty.
The latest heightened tension is only weeks old, and really, it's too early yet to judge the impact of that on tourism here. So far, the missing tourists are explained more by politics than fear.
Chinese tourists are the ones almost entirely absent. In March, China, angered by South Korea's deployment of the THAAD anti-missile system, banned its citizens from taking package tours to South Korea.
Last year, about half of the 17 million tourists to South Korea were from China. But this year, Chinese tourists are down by 70%.
That's being felt here.
It's hurting my business. Sales are roughly a third down.
In the longer term, there's concern about next year's Winter Olympics in Pyeongchang. Ticket sales so far are poor. The International Olympic Committee said last week there is no plan B to move the games if tensions escalate, but they can't make spectators come. South Korea's defense ministry on Monday said it believed the North was ready for a new nuclear test. If it comes, that will only heighten the tension and dissuade more tourists from visiting.
Eric?
Hello, Harris. Well, back in 2005, I interviewed then-developer Donald Trump, who wanted to renovate the UN building. He called this establishment either corrupt or incompetent. Well, he returned today as President of the United States and is holding it to account. The president attended a meeting on UN reform. He also met with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. But as you say, all eyes are on the speech tomorrow to the General Assembly, in which he will take North Korea to task. He is expected to call on the world body to unite against the threat posed by Kim Jong-un, even though the Security Council has so far over the last 11 years passed 9 resolutions. They have basically failed to rein that regime in. And the administration has raised the prospect of possible military action if indeed diplomacy does eventually fail.
This will be a great week. We look forward to it. As far as North Korea is concerned, I think that it's most of you that know how I feel.
And by the way, the North Korean delegation will be in the General Assembly a few rows from the president tomorrow as he speaks. We'll have to see, though, if they take his message to heart, Harris.
What about what also is expected to be talked about, and that is Iran?
Yeah, a major topic, of course. The president has threatened to tear up the Iranian nuclear deal, though he has been abiding by the regulated guidelines every 90 days to keep it going. Iranian President Hassan Rouhani is here at the United Nations today. Earlier, he met with the Secretary General Antonio Guterres. He speaks on Wednesday, and Rouhani is expected to lash out at the U.S. as well as defend the Iranian nuclear program. As he does on Wednesday, there will also be a massive rally against him just across the street. And the leader of the largest Iranian opposition group, the National Council of Resistance of Iran, Mariam Rajavi, says that simply Rouhani should be kicked out of the UN.
This regime is responsible for mass executions in Iran, for slaughter of the people of Syria, destructive meddling in Iraq, support for terrorism, and pursuing nuclear weapons and missile programs.
And we'll see how the president's America First message goes and plays down with the diplomats here, who basically have to rely on the largesse of American taxpayers to basically fund most of this organization.
Or we ought to think about just shoring up deterrence and going with containment. But I hasten to add, we have not exhausted a negotiated route, and I do not share General Clapper's view that we can forget about a non-nuclear Korean peninsula. I do believe in the long term, normalization is possible.
You believe that's still possible for North Korea to give up those nuclear weapons?
I do.
Sumi, do you agree with that?
I think it's highly unlikely that they will give up nuclear weapons.
Okay, let's go to Seoul. Yeah. Let me ask, can South Korea live with a nuclear-armed Kim Jong-un?
No, we cannot tolerate that. It is important to recognize that we have not exhausted the diplomatic means. What I'm saying is we have not yet fully implemented complete sanction against North Korea so that Kim Jong-un change his calculation of cost and benefit of nuclear option. The reason for that is that there was no close international coordination in applying sanctions against North Korea. For example, U.S. Put first priority on denuclearization, but China put first priority on regime stability of North Korea rather than denuclearization. So there was no close coordination yet.
Okay.
So how to achieve much closer coordination from now on? That is the key point, I think.
Charles, we're discussing whether North Korea would ever give up its nuclear weapons. And let me ask you this. A lot of people say they'll never give it up unless China is the one that makes them give it up. Is that fair?
Let's go back to what the former foreign minister had just said. He's absolutely right. China looks at the stability of the regime as much more important than denuclearization. The stability of the regime, if you talk about a regime change, if you continue to press for further sanctions, if you start taking fuel out and foodstuff out, you're looking at regime collapse. Is that something we want to see? 20 million well-indoctrinated people with 1.5 million in the armed forces, well-weaponized, started crossing the border both South Korea and China.
You tell me the one thing you'd like the US to do right now, and then I'll ask our two
at
US reps here what they think China should do.
I think at least, as China has been saying all along, engage, 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 and not pour more fuel on the fire.
Okay.
Fire and fury, you know?
Indeed.
Do we need that right now?
Sumi, what should China be doing? We heard from Charles what he thinks the U.S. should be doing.
I understand what he was saying about China's interest and priority, and China wants to avoid instability and regime collapse in North Korea. But China needs to see that we do not have much time left. And does China really want nuclear North Korea? What does that mean? That means possibly nuclear arms race in the Northeast Asian region, with South Korea possibly going nuclear, Japan following. There's potential nuclear proliferation. Now we're very close to conflict, more than ever before. I still think it's unlikely, but we are there. China is number one trading partner for South Korea. The trade volume between China and South Korea is double that of South Korea, US, South Korea, Japan combined. China needs to have, I think, they need to just sort of understand that there's interest and priority of just supporting North Korea. Giving blank check to North Korea has not worked. And we're not at the close to the end game here, and I think China needs to reevaluate.
You said earlier about, you know, the regime change wars being a problem, and Charles has talked about the need to engage. You said last week in an interview, I'm all for information warfare. We need to help the people of North Korea rise up. That's the long-term game. The North Korean people bring about the change we need. You can't really engage with North Korea if you're also encouraging regime change.
I'm not a promoter of engagement dialogue, only because I feel
that... Are you a promoter of regime change? Do you think that helps in the current crisis?
No, not in terms of United States doing decapitation of regime.
But supporting the people rise up.
But supporting people of North Korea, because the long-term game here is that we need a different regime to bring about non-nuclear North Korea, because Kim Jong-un is built on completing the program, and the only way to do that is to help people of North Korea bring about the change.
Do you agree with that, Robert?
No, I don't think I do quite the way Sumi has just laid it out. I do think, as I've said a couple of times, that there are possibilities for making movement with negotiations. I certainly do believe and like to accept your invitation to note to my colleague in China that the Chinese position has been, for me, a tad conservative. Given what he has said and we understand to be Chinese interests in the continuation of that regime, I do not know whether the next thing that happens will be a North Korean provocation and an American response which will bring American military and naval assets to the doorstep of China. That cannot be what the Chinese want next. And I would suggest that they should think about taking some risks in the direction of increased pressure. At the end of the day, though, I don't know that China will do that. And I think we still need to answer the question, will the United States and should the United States tolerate for now the continued fielding of this capability to strike the United States with an ICBM which the Americans cannot shoot down?
Charles, briefly, do you want to respond to that?
I support your discussions, about, your comments about engagement. Absolutely, there is still a chance. But I have to say, in China's case, bringing more American weapons or ships and planes to Chinese waters or Chinese border is nothing new for China. 13th Fleet has been there for a long, long time. China has been surrounded by the first island chain. I don't think it makes much difference if you bring a couple more nuclear carriers over. The key for China is stability. Stability so countries in the region can grow. As for Sumi's discussion about, China must do more and that there will be a nuclear arms race, it comes back to my point. Whether or not there will be a nuclear arms race in North Asia will also depend on whether or not the U.S. want that to happen.
On that note, Charles,
so
on that note,
China and the U.S.
Okay, on that note, let me ask Young Kwon in Seoul.
I think
the defense minister in South Korea recently said the U.S. should perhaps review its decision on whether or not to deploy tactical nuclear weapons to South Korea. Is that something you support? Many would say that would be just ratcheting up the conflict to the next level.
I think we, South Korean government and people, have to consider that option, as well as nuclear development of ourselves. Because if we accept North Korea as a nuclear power, there should be serious imbalance, a military security imbalance between the North and South. And South Koreans will feel threatened, and that naturally lead to their consideration of nuclear option or redeploying tactical nuclear weapons. I think China had better think about whether that kind of nuclear proliferation in this region will be beneficial for their own long-term security interest. I think China will suffer from that kind of new situation caused by North Korean nuclearization.
Well, let me just throw this in. China has been used to having both India and Pakistan, who are not very friendly with nuclear weapons on its borders.
Let me ask a question before we run out of time. I do want to ask you all a question which I'm sure many viewers at home will be asking, which is Kim Jong-un himself. Here is a young leader in his 30s. He's never met with a foreign leader. He now has potential to attack the United States with nuclear weapons. Is he irrational? Is he crazy? Is he suicidal? This is a question that's often asked. Let me ask all of you your take on the leader himself. Robert.
I don't have any reason to believe he's suicidal. I believe he could do the basic calculations necessary for deterrence. That's why I think we can depend upon deterrence as we have in Europe and as we have in Asia for a long time. It's not something that I want to translate into acceptance of the North Korean nuclear weapons program, because I quite agree. If we do that, then we do something to our extended deterrence to the South Koreans and to the Japanese and encourage them in a direction of nuclear weapons acquisition. But with respect to Kim Jong-un, I think that deterrence will work.
Young Kwon?
I think we need to assume that Kim Jong-un is not suicidal and Kim Jong-un cares much about his own survival as well as his regime's survival. I think under that assumption, I think we need to send a clear signal to North Korea. For example, what we want is policy change, not regime change, or a preventive war. So I think we need to send a clear signal consistently that we need policy change, and if they change their policy, we will provide some security guarantee or, regime stability. We will help them a lot. I think that's the assumption on which our engagement, South Korea's engagement policy, has been based on.
Charles, you visited North Korea, I believe. I mean, how does the reality of North Korean society and the way they treat their leader and the, you know, allegations of brainwashing match with what your experiences were on the ground?
I think much of the propaganda that we see coming out of Korea is really for domestic consumption. I think it's to maintain, of course, the nuclear deterrence is to maintain the regime and himself and his family and his cohorts. But the other part is really for domestic consumption. There has been significant transformation. I wouldn't say transformation yet, but changes in
on, and it was up 98% year to date.
Is that right?
Today's gains, you might get an even 100.
Wow.
But
what is
driving?
I know they've had some big orders, and just last week, Prime Minister of Malaysia here saying, yeah, we're going to order 20, maybe 40 of these planes, Dreamliners, but what else has happened?
So step back for a second, and you'll see aerospace defense have outperformed the S&P dramatically over 5 years, up about 160%. The S&P is up around 80%.
And that despite the fact that defense-related spending, say the last year, has actually been going down.
It dipped a little bit, but I think, you know, it's a scary world out there. We joke at Barron's that all of these, Boeing and Northrop and Rockwell, they all have great big portraits of Kim Jong-un in their boardroom. Because who better for sales than a crazy guy throwing missiles
into the... That's really what sped it up this year.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, one thing I find particularly interesting is people used to joke about Star Wars missile defense, how it would never work against Russia. And frankly, they had a point. That's an awful lot of ICBMs incoming, and we don't have a great track record to knock him down. But Kim Jong-un, he's not going to throw more than two or three. We can actually knock those down. Yeah. So today, Northrop announced it was buying Orbital ATK, which makes some of the components in these missile defense systems, and they really could protect us. So that's a good business to
now
be
that's
in.
Almost $10 billion, and I talk about the revised market. Bill and I was looking also at United Technologies and Rockwell Collins, $30 billion. Is much of this running up that's going on driven by still more deals and combos, or is it a standalone? The whole sector looks promising. The world's worrying.
Yeah, I think it's both. Everybody's on M&A watch, no question about it. We saw the the UTX hookup, and then today Northrop. But also, if you look around the world, I mean, Rydia, you know, is buying more and more from these companies because they're fighting in Yemen and they're worried about Iran.
Yeah.
But if you're in Eastern Europe, and you're our friend, you're probably going to be a customer because Putin is obviously, Japan and North and South Korea even are talking about getting more aggressive, and they don't have defense industries to speak of, you know, like we do. So they're going to be good customers too. So. You know, at Barron's, we never like to recommend a company that's doubled in a year. So we're a little shy, but at the same time, momentum investors know trends tend to continue, and I don't see any reason they wouldn't.
You know, you see a doubling in a stock, though, and I know trends continue, the environment favors it and all, but you do have to think, are we overly panicking? Are we overly fretting about Kim Jong-un or whomever? Or is it justified? Did we have this same kind of run-up with Ronald Reagan and defense stocks? With the Star Wars defense shields and all this other stuff. And of course, he committed himself at the outset of his presidency to a dramatic defense buildup. I mean, but is this president? We already spent quite a bit.
Yeah, and you do have to wonder how much more can you spend, the law of big numbers, right? Although today, correct, you guys are more on top of this than I am, but I think a bill is expected to pass to appropriate $700 billion in defense spending.
This is around $600 billion now.
Yeah, and that's about, what, 4.5 Boeings right there? Yeah. So there's clearly going to be a lot of money just on that side. But, you know, also, we haven't talked about the aerospace side. Boeing, actually, 70% of its revenues has nothing to do with defense. It's 787s and Dreamliners and all that. And, you know, it's a more globalized world. China is going to be a bigger market for these things. They're trying to get into themselves, of course, but,
Always worry, and maybe you mentioned this when you talked about Boeing and all these others, that if we get into a trade war with China over North Korea, the irony would be that some of the same defense issues that have run up could run down.
Sure. I mean, first of all, I won't get too much into geopolitics, but boy, I think we ought to sit down with China and say, look, forget about all the other stuff. Let's solve this Kim Jong-un problem. He's not good for you. He's not good for us. But that said, you're right. Trade wars could help because Airbus and Boeing, of course, are multinational companies. If it starts getting into a thing where, well, if they like Europe, they buy Airbus. If they like the U.S., they buy Boeing. That's not good. But there's a robust business. And yet another one is space. So that has to do with, that's probably why Northrop bought Orbital, or the number one reason.
Right.
And there's lots of other, you know, satellites now are like this big. It's like shoeboxes.
Yeah.
And so when you can send that many up, that's great for the rocket makers because it's not
China
like...
It's going big time.
Yeah, exactly. And we have to
Real quickly, is it your sense that China can't control North Korea? What if the dirty little secret is they can't rein them in? They've created a Frankenstein.
Yes, that is a very good question. I can't answer it for sure, except if you think about what does North Korea have? Just about nothing except for weapons. So yeah, they could sell, and this is very scary, like could to raise cash, does he start selling weapons to terrorists? Yeah, I think we definitely have to worry about that. But the point is,
could push him into a corner where that happens.
Exactly. But I think China, I mean, they starve without China's help. So I think if China really wanted to, they could help us. But then think about their end game. Well, what if South Korea takes over, you know, the northern half of the peninsula? They don't want that. So maybe having a crazy man there who's, you know, annoying the Americans and the Japanese is, maybe they don't mind that so much. We have to figure out a way how to make it in their interest to help us out on this one.
Is anyone going to go to next year's Winter Olympics in South Korea, though, in this environment?
Well, I remember the last time it was there. It did pretty well. I think they will. Yes, it's scary, but who knows? Maybe by then, maybe this will prod somebody to at least calm him down for a moment.
Or find a different place for the luge. Jack Otter of Barron's.com editor. Told you he was really, really smart.